Innovation is a key driver of economic growth, but what does the process of bringing a new product to market actually look like? In many industries, it is common for small firms to originate new products or ideas, only to be acquired by large incumbents while they are still in the early stages of product development. From an economic perspective, this is typically viewed as a positive phenomenon. Large established firms have many advantages that can make it easier for them to develop a new product, and acquisitions allow them to leverage these synergies. This paper proposes and tests a different motive for these transactions. Incumbents may acquire innovating firms in order to terminate their projects and quash future competition. Rather than facilitating innovation, these killer acquisitions aim to suppress it. To provide a framework for exploring these decisions, consider a market with several incumbent firms, each producing its own product, and an entrepreneur with an early stage project. Further development is needed to bring this product to market, and there are two paths that can facilitate this. First, an incumbent can acquire the entrepreneur and invest in development, in which case the project succeeds with probability PA. Alternatively, the entrepreneur remains independent and invests itself in development, succeeding with probability PE. If the project succeeds, the new product is brought to market and competes against those produced by the incumbents. So, let's consider the decision over whether or not to invest in further development. One reason the acquiring firm and the entrepreneur might make a different decision is that PA and PE may differ. In particular, we would generally expect PA to be greater than PE, reflecting the incumbent's relative advantages. In this case, and all else equal, an acquiring firm should be more willing to continue development. Crucially, however, there is another difference between the incumbent and the entrepreneur. The payoff of bringing a new product to market is strictly lower for the incumbent because the new product draws consumer demand and profits away from all existing products, including the incumbents. This effect is more pronounced the greater the similarity or overlap between the two products, and this leads the incumbent to be less willing than the entrepreneur to continue development. In fact, the authors show that this second effect can be large enough to incentivize a killer acquisition. The incumbent acquires the entrepreneur in order to terminate the project. More broadly, this model provides the following key predictions. First, projects acquired as part of an overlapping acquisition are less likely to be developed than those acquired as part of a non-overlapping one. Second, an incumbent has greater incentive to acquire and terminate an overlapping project when competition is low. Introducing a new product eats into existing profits, and the incumbent has more to lose from this when he is a monopolist that bears the brunt of the loss. When the market is competitive, the losses are spread over many firms. Finally, the model also predicts that incumbents will target for acquisition entrepreneurs with overlapping projects. To test these predictions in a real-world setting, the authors turn to the pharmaceutical industry. This is a highly innovative and economically important market, and drug development follows a standard set of milestones that allow the authors to track projects from early-stage development through to commercial launch or discontinuation. Their data track 16,000 projects originated by over 4,000 firms between 1989 and 2010, and, importantly, match these to corporate acquisition events over the same period. So, do we see evidence for killer acquisitions? The short answer is yes. Consistent with the model's predictions, projects acquired by an overlapping incumbent are 23.4% less likely to continue development compared to drugs acquired by non-overlapping incumbents. These differences only manifest after an acquisition, and are driven by cases in which incumbents have a stronger incentive to protect their existing profits. Namely, in markets with low levels of competition, and when the incumbent's overlapping drug is far from patent expiration. Importantly, there is also evidence that killer acquisitions are strategic and intentional. Acquisitions are nearly 4 times more likely to occur when the incumbent's products overlap with that of the target, and firms conducting killer acquisitions appear to pursue deals that avoid antitrust scrutiny. The Federal Trade Commission uses a cutoff rule to determine whether a proposed acquisition is subject to pre-merger review, while the distribution of non-overlapping acquisitions is relatively smooth around this cutoff. Overlapping acquisitions are bunched just below the threshold that would trigger regulatory scrutiny. The drug projects involved in these below-threshold deals are also terminated at much higher rates relative to those right above the threshold. This suggests that killer acquisitions are intentionally conducted under the FTC's radar. Overall, the authors estimate that between 5.3 and 7.4% of all deals in their sample are killer acquisitions. Should antitrust policy target such deals? The results imply that doing so would raise the pharmaceutical industry's overall development rate by 4%. Of course, this could also reduce incentives for innovation if some entrepreneurs are motivated by the prospect of later acquisition. In conclusion, this paper sheds light on the phenomenon of killer acquisitions and suggests that in other industries as well, incumbents with market power may stifle other firms' innovation in the name of protecting their profits. And so, there is a self-reinforcing mechanism to market concentration. Incumbents in already concentrated markets are incentivized to acquire and terminate their future product competitors, thereby further reducing competition. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes research on corporate acquisitions, papers exploring how market concentration affects innovation, and those that study these topics more particularly in the pharmaceutical industry.